In this video, I want to show you a really, really interesting cross-site scripting vulnerability in Google Docs. This was reported to Google in May by the bug bounty hunter Nikolai and was rewarded $4,133.70. Nikolai found this issue during the time he received a Google VRP grant, which is Google paying money for his work even if he finds nothing. But if he finds something, like this issue, he gets the bounty too. And in this video, we will not only look at the bug to see how it works, but hear from Nikolai how he found it, and I even got a chance to talk to Google engineers to learn their side of the story. Why did this vulnerability exist in the first place? I think this is awesome, and this is only possible thanks to Google sponsoring this video. Okay. Let's start with the bug report from Nikolai and click on his proof of concept URL. On this website, we can see an iframe embedding a Google spreadsheet, and just a short moment later, we see an alert pop up showing the affected origin docs.google.com. So let's have a look at the reproduction steps. How can we do the XSS ourselves? First, we have to create a spreadsheet and add some data to be used by an annotation chart, and then add that chart. When you make changes to this chart and look at the requests sent by Google Docs, you can find a post request to save the settings of this chart referenced by this chart ID. And there's this big JSON blob, which also contains options for this chart. Nikolai now wants us to modify this request and inject the following range option, which specifies a UI type and set it to HLC. We forward this request and the first important step is done. This is very weird. Why do we do that? We will get to that in just a moment, but first let's follow the remaining steps. Next, we have to share the spreadsheet, get the URL of it, and create a malicious website that iframes this document. And then add code to our website to execute a post message call to this iframe, specifying a URL that points to a JavaScript with an alert? Okay. If you don't know what postMessage does, it enables cross-origin communication between window objects, for example, between a page and an iframe embedded within it. Because of the historical issues of JavaScript accessing other websites and the introduction of the same origin policy, there exists now the postMessage API that allows you to exchange messages with other websites. But those websites then also need a postMessage listener to react to it. This way, you can have safe communication between different sites. But apparently, the postMessage handler from Google Docs is dangerous because it takes a link to some JavaScript and executes it. This malicious website can simply ask Google Docs to execute any script. That is insane. But obviously, Google Docs doesn't do this by default. That would be very bad. And that's where the super confusing UI type set to HLC comes into play. Check this out. It gets crazy. If you look into the waffle.js prod code JavaScript sources and search for HLC, you can find an HLC function, which indeed adds an onMessage event listener where it takes a URL parameter and simply creates a script element with this URL as the source and then appends the script to the document body, which will trigger the execution of the script. Okay, well, this still makes no sense because, yes, we have a function that does register this dangerous postMessage handler, but how is this HLC function even executed? And this goes into what gviz, the graph visualization library from Google Spreadsheet, does with the UI type option. Deep inside the library, there is a function which handles this UI type option. It gets the specified UI type HLC as a string and looks for an actual existing function, object, variable, or whatever. And when it is found, it calls new on it. So it expects the UI type option to specify a name for a constructor for some kind of UI type class. But Nikolai realized that you can make it instantiate arbitrary other objects, and he found this HLC function, which gets executed when used here as a constructor. What? So to summarize, by specifying HLC as a UI type in the options, Nikolai can force Google Docs to execute this HLC function, which registers a postMessage handler that takes any URL, creates a script tag of it. When then embedding the spreadsheet into his own website, it allows him to inject an arbitrary script into Google Docs, leading to this cross-site scripting issue. Wow. Okay, so how the XSS is executed is clear now, but now I have even more questions. How did Nikolai find this UI type option and that it gets executed as an arbitrary constructor? How did he find the weird HLC function? Why does this HLC function even exist? What is the legit use of this? So many questions, and I'm glad I could talk to Nikolai and Googlers to answer them. So let's meet the legend, Nikolai. Findings like this one here rarely come out of the blue. This is clearly a very involved exploit, and there is probably prior experience and history to this. So let's hear about Nikolai's previous work.
I started to test the gviz library, so Google Visualization API, take care of all the points of integration within like Google systems, so spreadsheets, former Fusion tables, Data Studio from new one, Public Data Explorer, they're also using the gviz. And I reported actually a lot of bugs in terms of library itself. And some of bugs were also related to integration. So library itself doesn't contain it, but taking into account the way integration is made, it's possible to exploit it as an XSS. All those issues were XSS only.
This is very important. He knows that gviz is a JavaScript library used across many Google products to draw all kinds of charts, and so he is somewhat specialized on that. He also noted that there are generally two classes of issues he finds: issues directly in the library itself, which could affect all users of it, and there are issues of what he calls integration, where the library is maybe used in an insecure way. Also, all of the issues are XSS issues, but that's no surprise. Gviz is a front-end drawing library. What else would it be? Anyway, let's have a small detour and look at different but related XSS issues that Nikolai found in the past. On some sites that use gviz, he found a way to set arbitrary chart types in the config. And then when I had a call with Google security engineers, they showed me this chart wrapper example, which only now during making of this video I realized is exactly what Nikolai was talking about. Here's the chart type, and you can see that the chart type is a string. The Googlers then told me that gviz internally calls the Google closure library function getObjectByName. So this resolves the string to an actual class or object, in this case the column chart class, so that it can be instantiated. Notice the similarities to ui.type of this new XSS. We saw that the ui.type as a string HLC was also resolved to an object and then instantiated with new. Turns out, handling the UI type and handling the chart type results in the same code path. Back then, Nikolai realized if he can control the chart type string, he can pass an arbitrary object path and it will be resolved and executed. Some people call this a JavaScript gadget. This is not directly XSS, but it's a gadget that allows you to basically call some other existing function. So now you have to think, can I execute something that gives me even more power? And he found a very interesting function called drawFromUrl. So being able to set an arbitrary chart type and pointing it at this weird drawFromUrl function, which will eventually execute, allows him to create a new chart with options he fully controls based on getParameter. And now I'm not sure, but I think you can just select options that basically create the chart with some HTML rendered parts and trigger a XSS through that. This has a lot of similarities with this XSS issue, right? But this happened in the past, and this obviously was fixed.
I reported this issue. This issue was accepted, so I get the bounty. Then this issue was fixed. I reported one more issue, how to get rid of this fix. It was fixed again. And the last fix that was applied is that there are only a whitelist of allowed chart types or names that can be supplied as a value of chart type parameter. That fix was applied, as far as I remember, let's say 2 years ago, or 1.5 years ago. But recently, before I found this bug we are talking about, due to some reason, I don't know, maybe there were no regression testing or some piece of old code was merged to the new branch, I don't know this. I noticed that currently now it is allowed one more time. It was allowed in the past to provide any string you want. There were no check, no whitelist for the case, this option UI type.
So he found that old XSS via the chart type. It got fixed, a whitelist was introduced, and this is where we come back to our current XSS, triggered by the UI type, because this whitelist got removed. So of course I wanted to know from the Google engineers, why? What happened? They jokingly told me the security team was actually responsible for this. This was not a regular engineer. The original whitelist fix was tied to a save mode flag that you can set for your chart. When turned on, it sanitizes any HTML rendering and also restricts the calling of arbitrary other constructors through, for example, chartType. But then recently, a Google security engineer came in and wanted to restructure this code by moving this flag away from the local setting per chart and have it be a global setting for when the library is loaded. Basically have a legacy and a safe mode for the entire library. And the Googler admitted that he forgot to wire this new global flag to all the same places where the local flag was used, causing this issue to regress and resurface. Okay, so the blurry picture about this bug slowly clears up, but there are still remaining questions. When I first got to read this bug report, I was wondering where the UI type even comes from. Inserting this into the options seems so arbitrary. And you can't simply read the source code because gviz is not open source. You can use it and it has a lot of documentation on how to create charts, but the UI type is mentioned nowhere. And the library is compiled, minified, and thus kinda obfuscated and difficult to read. So you might be burning to hear how Nikolai found this UI type option in the first place. And this is where he went back in time again and explained to me how he found the other issue with the chart type, because it led to the UI type.
I found it just by looking at the obfuscated source code and looking the places when chart type is getted from somewhere and injected to somewhere. I found a lot of such places, let's say 20, 30, and go step by step doing this like reverse engineering and checking from what place can I influence it, or it's hard-coded, or it's getting from something. And that was the reason actually I found this stuff with UI type. It's not documented.
So he actually simply used tools like JS Beautifier, or what I learned from Google JS Nice, to read through the compiled code and kind of reverse engineer it. And that's how he learned about the internals.
So UI type is actually undocumented option of controls behavior. So if you are creating control, basically there are nothing to do with even annotation chart itself, because you can just provide chart type or control type as a real control. I mean range selector or number range filter or string filter. So just the documented controls from the visualization library. And I don't remember exactly, maybe all of them, maybe not all of them, need to check. If you are providing this UI type option, it is overriding the control type.
This is just incredible to me. The dedication and perseverance after many years of already looking into this library and still finding new XSS issues. Huge respect. So it's clear now how he found the undocumented UI type option. He analyzed the code path of the control type option and found that there is the undocumented UI type that can overwrite it. And now we know what it leads to. gviz simply gets the object based on the provided name and interprets it as a constructor calling new on it. Nikolai also told me he reported this once before, but then used the old code reuse technique with the drawFromUrl function, which was then fixed by removing this gadget function. But that's not a proper root cause fix. That just removes one of the usable gadgets. So logical progression is now to ask, what other functions can I call? Here's what Nikolai said about that.
Initially, I mean, 3-4 years ago, when I found the draw from URL XSS, I just looked at all methods within Google.visualization, not looking at other stuff, just to methods within Google visualization. And that issue with draw from URL was found using this approach. After it was fixed, I just started thinking about what can I call else. So if I do not have the draw from URL method, what can I do?
And yes, then you just start by going through all the available functions one by one and look if they are useful to you. And eventually you come across this HLC function that registers a post message that you can abuse to inject an arbitrary script. Amazing. I think now I understand Nikolai's side of this bug. It's clear to me how he found it, how he approached it, and how he thought about it. But I also had the chance to talk to Google, and so I wanted to know why the heck does this function even exist? And it turns out it's the fault of security engineers again. Let's look where HLC is used. It's actually never called. It's only used once here, where it is embedded as a string. This DLC function creates an iframe, a sandboxed iframe, only allowing scripts to be executed where it embeds this function. This might look weird, but this is actually a security mitigation. This is a so-called JSONP sandbox. JSONP is this horrible design idea to make cross-origin exchanges work. Basically, instead of returning simply JSON, which with default same origin policy couldn't be read by another website, an API endpoint can wrap the data into a function call. Then when the other website wants this data, it simply creates a function of that name, embeds this as a JavaScript, which is then executed and passed the data to you. So not only is JSONP used to get around the browser same origin policy in a hacky way, because you can often control the function name that's able to place arbitrary JavaScript in here, it can be used as a CSP bypass, or even many websites create XSS issues through that. So Google doesn't want to execute these JSONP scripts on the main page for security reasons, and instead creates a sandboxed iframe where they register an event handler which they can use to send over the possibly dangerous JSONP endpoint. It gets executed and the iframe can respond back with the data. If something evil happened in this iframe, it doesn't affect the site around it. It's a very clever security mitigation. Unfortunately, it also created a gadget function which Nikolai could reuse with his first gadget, the arbitrary object creation, resulting in XSS. So Google fixed gviz by using a proper whitelist again and also added an origin check for the post message in this gadget function, so it can't be abused in this way anymore. Awesome. Before we wrap up this video, I also asked Nikolai about his background because I think it's always interesting where people are coming from. Does he have a lot of developer experience because he can work through compiled JavaScript code so well? But
I do not have like a real development background, so I never was a developer. I have like basic understanding of JavaScript language, understanding of arrays, methods, but I'm not a developer, so I do not have like very huge domain expertise in development itself. A lot of time ago, I was quality assurance engineer, then manager of software development, but I never was developer.
Quality assurance. Interesting. Especially when you look at his company, this is QA. On here, he also writes, our audits are powered by people, not by automated tools. And I think this XSS is the perfect example because no automated scanner tool would have ever found this. No chance. It's so complex and intertwined that you'd need a human like Nikolai to review that. What an amazing XSS. And what I love especially about it is that it's all the Google security team's fault.